I think we're in for a very enlightening expose of the energetic city from an architect's perspective. Please join me in welcoming Greg Allen.
I hope you all saw Wally. Compelling story. I chose it because I wanted to bring some levity to what is otherwise a rather heavy topic that we are engaged in today. And we do need to take this with the enthusiasm which I feel in this room as an opportunity for recreating ourselves, a kind of joyous experience rather than the depressing attributes of trying to maintain the status quo. So much of what I've heard about this morning is right on line with my own feelings on the matter of the change that we're undergoing right now. When considering the topic of an architect's vision of an energetic city, I realized that this is too all-encompassing. It's everything about our lives. And to be energetic, I would infer, means to be vital. So we are talking about the viability and the vitality of our world. I have been known to go on at length about the nature of the problem that we face, so that I don't have to do that. I'm just going to ask you to read the following premises of the presentation I'll be giving. There, now I don't have to say anything negative. The nature of the problem is akin to what those who are inclined to view ourselves as frontiersmen and go off to other planets. In the exercise of imagining how humans could inhabit the universe, we come across this term terraforming, which is how do we recreate Earth on dead planets? Well, I think it's very akin to the nature of the problem that we're facing with our own society here on Earth, that what we have done has been to exhaust the resource bases and create habitats that are relatively devoid of life. What we're trying to do now is to reinvent ourselves as part of a viable ecosystem so our living is consistent with the living of the rest of the Earth. And of course, I think in order to do this, it's not simply using the tools of the past, it is changing the way we think. That's called a paradigm shift. We have been, from the beginning, dawn of civilization, on a path of hierarchic structures of society and a notion that humanity had supremacy over the planet. And here we come to an end of that era of there being frontiers, that we are now on a collision course with the capacities of this spaceship Earth to accommodate our ever-increasing growth. And we realize that now we're in a closed sphere, the dome being the best emblem. And of course, this one is at the South Pole, so that's the extremities that we have now reached in a human population of the planet. The movement, as I sense it, I think I'm in good company. I read that Albert Einstein, who says lots of things, had noted that the second greatest idea, insight into the nature of the world, besides his own relativity theory, was a notion called holarchy. Now, that hasn't made the mainstream of terminology in our everyday life. Amongst ecologists, they understand the term. Essentially, it says that the structure of the universe consists of, from the small to the large, integrities, and that these integrities self-maintain, and they exchange energy, materials, and information at higher levels. Those higher levels have greater complexity, but are dependent on the subsets. So if you think about it, our body is made up of cells. The well-being of those cells is absolutely crucial to the well-being of our organs, and our organs are essential for the well-being of our beings. And then our communities beyond that are essential for our well-being. So we're a nested integrity inside a much larger system. And I thought that that would be a good framework of how we can think about the problem of redesigning our world as if it were alive, because it is alive and it needs to be brought more to life. So we have structured ourselves somewhat along governance of having regions. I'll call them bioregions as an appropriate biological equivalent. And then our cities, and then our precincts, our neighborhoods, and then the individual buildings as a kind of parallel description. And whereas we have tended to have a kind of hierarchical legal framework and administration structure in this regard, I think that we need to recognize that all of these parts are interdependent with each other, the communication of information amongst the different levels, the consistency of the kind of activities that take place on all those levels will be resonant throughout the system. It's otherwise known as fractal design. Nature's designed fractally. I'm going to just simplify this to the exchanges of matter, life, and energy as they are patterned here on prairies. We already have an intimate relationship between the extraction of those resources from our bioregion. What we haven't done is to recycle and to find compatibility of what happens at the local level so that there's a continuous exchange of materials and a continuous input of solar radiation that supports the whole of the proposition of a city. That is where we need to go to, as the biological premise of this planet is solar income and not the extraction of ancient sunshine. Brief overview of the bioregion. We have challenges with the shifting climate. The boreal forest is under infestation, dying, and will go up in fire. I know that there's efforts to extract the wood before that takes place. Concomitant with that should be the enormous effort to conceive of what the replacement biological systems will be necessary, that human beings can encourage the rapid replacement of our forests with the given climate change scenario. There are ideas around that where we could create fuels from those resources, create biochar to sequester carbon in the soils, regenerate the soils, and answer a lot of the transitional problems that we face to get to a fully renewable energy future. Of course, grain had traditionally been the lifeblood of the communities on the prairies and will continue to be so. This must be our breadbasket. On the lower right hand, you'll see a mapping of the transition that is anticipated for where grain will grow over the next 50 years. And you notice that it's moving considerably north of where it is right now. It's also maps onto the current excavations at the tar sands, so that may be an added consideration about the wisdom of what we're doing. The lower left, this is a agricultural production, not dissimilar from here, that is harvesting the waste organics and creating biogas on the farm, creating an enhanced fertilization for the fields, and at the same time the gas is being scrubbed and put into the existing infrastructure. So it's replacing the natural gas. I don't know why we call it natural gas. This is natural gas. It would be able to be supplanting what we're currently using from the drilled form. One thing that I think is a premise of sustainability is that we can no longer continue to excavate and scar the earth in the pursuit of our resources. So mining will have to end. Not only is waste bad and we need to reduce waste, no, waste is resource and needs to be continuously recycled. That's the lesson from nature. It is a continuously reconfigured resource for our needs, and it so happens to be much more energetically efficient. The other image is of the Bow Glacier, and the prospects of the glacier actually melting would shut down about 50% of the water flow coming to town. This should be information that's flowing to cities, energy generators, irrigation of our fields. All of that feedback needs to be starting to come into play in order that we start the reconfiguration of our new world. Some of it is already underway here, and your tremendous wind resource is now being well exploited, great compatibility with the agricultural practices of the prairies. I think that concentrated solar technology will also come to the prairies. You have an extremely high level of available solar radiation here, and those advancements have made solar of this type the least cost energy form. We're going to be moving things back and forth, but probably to a much lesser extent, as I hope to demonstrate in the later images. But we'll need to move back and forth still. And rail, this image is part of the vision of the president to create a high-speed rail system throughout America. We need more advocacy here for this proposition. These fast rail systems are run on electricity and could be powered along the route by generating opportunities. In fact, the railway can be part of a power corridor to bring in the resources from the bioregion in the form of electricity. On the right is an image of pipelines, which have traditionally been a one-way street. I know there has been in Alberta research on the use of pipelines to move materials. So encapsulated materials in pipelines with pneumatic propulsion of that is already a concept that's being applied in Japan. Your grain could be moved through those pipelines. The nutrients that are otherwise going into our rivers can be generated into fertilizer that would be returned to the fields and any number of other exchanges as a very efficient material handler of those added distance problems that we face. Now, within the city, similar cycles take place, but at each level there's an appropriate solution. The same elements are the same. We want to get, as we get smaller in, more closely recycling of materials, because many things don't do well of having to be shipped long distances. So again, looking at those exchanges. In Cuba, of course, they've had the challenge of going off oil much earlier than the rest of us. And finally, after realizing that the big commune farms were dead in the water as a proposition, they allowed there to be agricultural productivity take place in a market setting, and these occurred within and around the perimeter of Havana, now supplying the food needs of a large city, sometimes called a re-rurification of our suburbs. Our suburbs constitute the natural hinterland for food production of cities. They again could become, as we start to emulate better models of older European communities, the market gardens of our densified parts of the city. So these new communities will be tighter and dedicated to the capacity of food growing. Similarly, nature needs to penetrate through our world so that it isn't just about us, it's about reciprocity between us and the rest of the living world on which our health is dependent. So respecting that and providing habitat corridors and biodiversity and food for the animals and other part of the biotic community that we need to nurture needs to be brought home right down into the core. We do have this large wastewater treatment system. This is a paradigm of the past. It's a very centralized means of collecting all of the water that runs off of the city and all of the wastewater that's flushed into it. Use an intensive amount of energy and chemistry to try to secure an outcome of the outflow back into the Bow River so that the folks downstream aren't too offended by what we're discharging. Whereas water is a resource in any other context, this functionality will have to change to a more distributed form. On the right is downtown Paris, 100% waste diversion facility that has a green roof, and this is kind of the edge that we need to get to, that it's not a matter of just continuously shrinking it, it's conceptualizing how we're going to get to zero waste and 100% reuse of the material flows. Cities can serve important functions in terms of infrastructure for energy. Biofuels will play an important role, but I'll emphasize that these biofuels should not be from dedicated crops, but from the residuals of other food generation, primarily. And that the processing of those fuels is probably appropriately located in the perimeters of the city. On large-scale public properties, in this case it's Coney Island's subway station, a deployment of large arrays of photovoltaics is an example of the kind of appropriate renewable technology generation that we might look to. Now, within the city, I think most of us have heard of the smart grid by now, which is creating the equivalent of an internet communication system with electricity so that every consumer becomes a producer. Every end use is a utility asset, becomes part of a system by which you can optimize the components of that system in terms of energy storage, in terms of energy generation, in terms of energy consumption. The economics that will be generated of this will be enormous, and we will solve a lot of our problems of dispatchable electrical generation, which is now dependent on fossil fuels primarily. Other infrastructure such as transportation, I'm pleased to hear that we're starting to evolve to people-friendly streets. This is in Melbourne, where they have affected, well, there's no longer a curb, there's no differentiation from the pedestrian zone and the public transit zone and the street life. which has made Melbourne a very livable city. Now, at the neighborhood level, even more intensive action of exchanges start to take place. We already saw an image about the growth of algae. This is one vendor of technology. At a building level, we could be growing using wastewater from our buildings as the nutrient source, algae in these intense agricultural production facilities to produce biodiesel and the various other values that can be taken from the most rapidly growing, highly efficient photosynthesis biological system that we have. On the right is an image of a fellow named Will Allen that came back to his hometown Milwaukee, finding his neighborhood in poverty and hunger, and being the son of a sharecropper, knew how to farm. And he created in the industrial wastelands of the community these complex agricultural production facilities that have the youth at risk now farming for their own food in their own communities, and with huge amounts of spin-off benefits that are occurring. In this case, the fish waste is used to fertilize the plants that fish is harvested. The organic waste is used to heat the greenhouses. And so he's getting in the real food chain that we need to belong to. Also at a local level, I think that the absence of things like repair shops, remaking things, in this case computers that are refitted, all of that is appropriately done at the neighborhood level. So finding those spaces where the shoe repairman can do their trade is what gets people to this country started in the economy and is of vital importance to making best use of our resources. We can use wastewater at a community level to create high-intensity vertical farms to produce food and purify the water in the same process. Areas where there's pavement can be canopied for improving the environment in the summer and produce both heat and power. This is an Ottawa company that produces these concentrator solar conversion equipment. On the right is a district energy system that uses thermal energy storage, which is an important component of when we start thinking about combined heat and power systems and district energy systems, that we can store energy readily in heat and not so readily in electricity. So if we can dispatch our electricity from the generation for the grid needs and store that thermal energy for the district heating system, we have an optimal outcome. And thermal, of course, can only happen at a local level because of the cost of transporting relatively lower grade energy. In terms of exchanges, in order to get a robust economy where all of these smaller industrial activities of constantly recycling materials and production of food within the city need a place to exchange. And of course, our cities and their origins in North America had these markets. In fact, we call it the marketplace, which is an allusion to what marketplaces really meant, which were where we could go and exchange the fruits of our labor. Of course, in Europe, district energy system is commonplace. It does involve ripping up the streets again, but with an integrated approach, there are some things that could be done with all of our infrastructure to be more coordinated in the act of putting distributed energy systems in play. Now, finally, at a building level, which is what I'm more familiar with, when we say architecture, we generally think of the buildings themselves. Most of what we are going to be confronted with is what we've already built. Tearing it down is a resource waste like you wouldn't believe. It's about 10 years of operating energy to build a building in the first case. The production of steel, glass, and concrete is an enormous environmental impact and a large amount of energy input to do that. Our buildings here have good bones. They are capable of being transformed and done so at a very profitable level if we do it on a coordinated plan. Buildings change, they have parts wear out. When we do the replacement, we're not just replacing what we had, we start to improve the thermal performance of the envelope. There are brilliant technologies around to do that. We change out the mechanical systems, we change out the daylighting systems, and we can get buildings that are able to be operated at about 10% of the energy that they currently consume, and the skins of their building able to produce more power than is required by the building themselves. So our end use of energy becomes a net producer of renewable energy generation. And that's not just an aspiration, but in fact, being deployed in new construction, the next ingenuity is going to be to solve that for our existing built structure. So we went through an exercise in Toronto on a real project where the building was being change of ownership. We derived a second skin around the old building with the vacuum insulating glass that had solar control devices to get the illumination into the building. We also created green space in the building with the greenhouse on the roof, breathing walls that do part of the mechanical air cleaning and humidity control, and greened the parking lot so that we brought a lot of literal greenness to the project. By doing a number of these things, the conditioning of the air in the space could be done virtually without energy by natural convection and heat recovery of energy waste. Bringing life to our buildings is being expressed in a whole variety of ways on the surfaces of the building, on the perimeter of the building, on the roof of the building, but now into the core of the building. So we have these biophilic ambitions of architecture right now, where we have an affinity to have houseplants around us. That's being writ large now in terms of architectural design and becomes part of the functionality of our building cores. And rooftop greenhouses that can be opened up in the summer, these will be the new urban farms. In terms of matter, opportunities like the image on the left is a hempcrete product that uses lime and hemp as the structural fiber to provide insulated blocks and are thereby actually sequestering carbon. So we're taking carbon out of the atmosphere while we're producing new buildings. This is a net sum game of our activities. And of course, wastewater can be cycled effectively within buildings so that the gray water is rendered reusable and creates delight and growing opportunities within the shell. Buildings are also opportunities for siting of renewables. These are both wind and photovoltaics. The two examples here, one in Chicago, is showing how you can configure wind turbines to take advantage of the accelerated velocities that come up over roofs. Architecture is now starting to look at forming buildings to provide venturis to do further capture of the wind potential. On the right is a photovoltaic system that isn't opaque. It actually uses holographic refractors to concentrate the sunlight on a smaller solar array while maintaining visibility through the windows behind. So it's providing solar shade, removing glare from the building, but allowing the daylighting through and the view through. And in terms of exchange, I wondered about the various things that I should choose for illustrating the elements of the principle of this holarchic structure. The one on the left is particularly compelling to me, which is a fairly common now in Sweden. These are urine-separating toilets. The urine is actually going down the front, and as long as men sit too, it works. It's about 0.3-liter flush on the number two and zero on the number one. The purpose of this is to capture where most of the nutrients exist, which is in our urine. The PNK content and trace minerals is ideal, and we're pissing it away. And it turns out some dosing with zeolite and the crystals drop out, and you've got a fertilizer to die for. We have a rich resource ready to be captured, and I only know, other than where we were everywhere in the world 100 years ago, Sweden is the only advanced country that's getting back to the realization of that enormous opportunity to solve our problems of potash mining finitude and nitrogen from a declining resource, natural gas. And finally, the plug-in car opens up this notion of vehicle-to-grid opportunity, so that your car not only takes power when the utility has got it available, so it's able to store electricity when you need it, when you've got it, but also capable in the hybrid mode to put power back into the grid. It's an asset on the grid, the value of which to the utility is sufficiently high that they could buy us all one of these cars. The economics is enormous when we start to get smart and start closing cycles and using things in multiple modes. Another example is the emergency power, which for every one of these large buildings sits there idle. Actually, they fire it up once a week just to make sure it works. That could be generating power on demand. There is all the capacity that we need in situ if we were to apply our attention to how to overcome the barriers that prevent us from doing this. And that's my wrap-up, my plea. Thank you.
a striking example of bringing the horizon into the room and showing us visually the art of the possible.